Well, today's the big game. Finally. After all the press conferences and all the hype and all the anticipation, it's time for Super Bowl XLVIII. That's 48 for all you non-Roman numeral speaking folks. Someone described the Super Bowl like this. It's 100 million people desperately in need of exercise, watching 22 guys desperately in need of rest. Here's a few fun facts about the Super Bowl. An estimated 60 million of us Americans will attend a Super Bowl party later today. How many of you are going to be at a party later today? See? A whole bunch of you. And at those parties, of course, there's going to be plenty of food. Did you know that now Super Bowl Sunday is second only to Thanksgiving Day in terms of food consumed in a single day in America? It's true. Talking about food, let's start with one of the five basic food groups, chicken wings. Didn't mean to make you hungry. How many chicken wings do you think will be consumed today? How about this? 1 billion. I looked it up. Several people confirmed that for me. I didn't believe it. I thought that was a misprint. But I did the math, and if about 180 million people around the world are watching, that's only about 5.5 wings per person, and I can easily do my share. Patriotic duty, 5.5 wings. Some lady mentioned to me after service last time that she wasn't going to eat any. I had to eat 10. I accept. It's fine. How about guacamole? Personally, I don't eat anything that color, but many of you do. Americans will eat 100 million pounds of avocados today. Someone figured out, I don't know who does this, but if you put all that guacamole on one football field, it'd be 11 and a half feet deep. Just dive in, right? Just dive in. And if you're like me, you look forward to the commercials as much as anything. Today we're going to see roughly 45 commercials during the game, and the cost of a single 30-second TV ad is $4 million this year. That's $133,000 a second. I did the math there too, and it would take about 1 minute and 8 seconds to pay for our entire Growing to Serve project at that rate. It's kind of depressing, actually. Some people will actually go to the game. How many of you know someone personally who's going to the Super Bowl today? Did you ask them how much their ticket cost? I'm just kidding, that'd be inappropriate. But the ticket prices are going from anywhere from $1,500 for the cheapest seat, nosebleed section, to over $1 million for a luxury box. And whether people are watching at home or watching in person, everyone will be hoping for their team to win, right? Show of hands. How many of you are hoping that the Seahawks win? That's what I thought I'd see. How many are hoping that the Broncos win? God's team, right? Although God's got a real problem here because several of the Seahawks have done a video where they're talking about their faith in Jesus. And you got the Broncos with Peyton Manning who's like a solid believer. So God's got a real problem on his hands, right? Anyway, but hope. Super Bowl's about hope. Everybody's hoping. But what is hope? There are really two ways to think about hope. First, hope as optimistic uncertainty. Hope. That is, you hope your team wins the Super Bowl, but you don't know for sure. You can't see the future. You don't know what's going to happen, but you hope for a certain result. Hope. Optimistic uncertainty. But there's a different kind of hope. Hope as certainty. Completely different. John Piper, a pastor, says, when you read the word hope in the Bible, it's not hope as wishful thinking. Christian hope is when God has promised that something is going to happen and you put your trust in that promise. And then he uses this line. Hope is faith in the future tense. Hope is faith in the future tense. Today we continue our series called The Way of Delight, Growing in God's Word. This is the 5th of 6 weeks in Psalm 119. We began the series by reading from Psalm 119, verses 14 through 16. Let me read these verses for you again. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. We encouraged you to do several things. One was to read through Psalm 119 during these 6 weeks. The other was to maybe go to 10 Minutes with God, our online devotional guide being written this month by Stephanie Rishi, a member of our congregation. Wonderful writer, does a wonderful job. You can listen to her 5 times a week or read the devotional guide. I hope you're doing that right now, 10 Minutes with God, on our website. And we encourage you to memorize that last verse. So I wonder if you can say it with me again. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. Now, don't look at the screen. Say it with me. I delight in your decrees. Eye contact. I will not neglect your word. Thank you for that. Now, today we're going to look at the subject of hope. What does God's word teach us about hope? Verse 41 out of Psalm 119. May your unfailing love come to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your promise. Then I will answer the one who taunts me, for I trust in your word. Do not snatch the word of truth from my mouth, for I put my hope in your word. Now, we all know there are different ways to read. For example, the way I read the newspaper, I just scan it. I scan looking for high points and headlines and stuff like that. We can scan. Or we can read the way I learned to read through graduate school, sort of the Cliff Notes way of reading books. I learned that if I read the introduction of a book, the conclusion of the book, then the first and last paragraph of each chapter, I could pretty much hit the high points and gather the point of the book. Or we can read for detail, the way you might read a contract or the instruction manual for building a model airplane or something. There are also different ways to read the Bible. We can read the Bible for volume, like trying to read the Bible through in a year. How many of you ever tried to do that? Read the Bible through in a year. It's a great thing to do, by the way. You get the whole content, the sweep of Scripture, but it does kind of tempt you to read for sheer volume, to sort of skim through parts of it like Numbers and Leviticus and Deuteronomy and stuff like that. Or you can read the Bible kind of as a professional. Jeff and I talk about this. It's a great blessing, but it's also a little bit of a pitfall. You tend to read for looking for outlines, thinking of illustrations or how to present the material. Or you can read the Bible in order to listen to God, to listen to God speak to you personally, a kind of devotional reading that the Benedictines used to call Lectio Divina, or divine reading, a more contemplative way of reading Scripture. I'm going to try a little bit of that today. I'm still going to be a sermon, but here's the way we would go through it in a contemplative way. Let's go to the text, verse 41. The psalm writer says, "May your unfailing love come to me, O Lord." Let's stop there. May your unfailing love come to me. God's word is telling us that God's unfailing love is for me, is for you. A number of years ago, we did a baptism at the East Campus, and a lady was baptized who was relatively new to our church at that time. She has since moved away. She was in her 50s or 60s, and I still remember part of her faith story. She said that she grew up in a painful family, lots of dysfunction, lots of addiction issues, had carried those unhealthy patterns into her adolescent life and created all sorts of problems for herself. But in the context of telling her story, she actually said that through all those years, I just assumed God hated me, she said. I just assumed God hated me. And she said that before coming to FBCG, even though she had grown up her whole life in the Chicagoland area, in our culture, she had never heard anyone say that God loved her. She had never heard the gospel. Astonishing to me. But what is unfailing love? The Hebrew word used here is hesed. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, probably not, but hesed, it's a unique word, almost always used in reference to God, and it carries the meaning of loving kindness, favor, mercy, or steadfast love. Martin Luther, the great reformer, thought the best translation was grace or gracious love. So hesed is a combination of God's love, grace, and mercy that is always undeserved by those who receive it. It's the nature of hesed. Now, we've all heard the saying, if it seems too good to be true, it must be too good to be true. Our cynical culture teaches us that there's always a catch. We'll all be thinking that way as we watch commercials this afternoon. There's got to be a catch. Someone's always selling something. There's no such thing as a free lunch. So I think we have a hard time believing and accepting God's salvation. We have a hard time accepting the gospel because we have a hard time with hesed, with unfailing love. Many years ago, while I was a graduate student in my mid-20s, before I was married, I was wrestling greatly with God's call on my life. I had been rejected from a graduate program I really thought he wanted me to go to, got that rejection letter, and I was thrown into confusion. I didn't know what he wanted me to do, and I was wrestling with that. One night I was praying, trying to pray all the right things. God, show me what you want me to do with my life. Show me what you want, where you want me to go. And through his spirit, not out loud, but sort of in my heart, he whispered to me my name, and he said, Brian, I love you. I said, yeah, I know, but I need to know where you want me to go. What do you want me to do? And he said it again, Brian, I love you. I said, I know that. I've always known that. But where am I supposed to go? What do you want me to do? And he said it the third time. this time a little more firmly. Brian, he didn't say this, but shut up and listen. I love you. What he wanted me to know is before I could do all that stuff, before I could go to this or that school or this or that program, I needed to know and hear his unfailing love for me. You see, we long to be loved, and at the same time, there's something just hard about being loved unfailingly. Like that lady years ago, we have a hard time believing anyone, let alone God, can love us unfailingly. Scripture says God never has a bad day. He never forgets our name. He never withdraws his love from us. And we know we don't deserve that kind of love. We know we don't love with that kind of love. We fear that if someone really knew us, then surely they would withdraw their love from us. And many of us have experienced that. And God knows everything about us, so surely he would withdraw his love from us. But the psalm says, may your hesed, may your unfailing love come to me, O Lord. That's where the gospel starts. Let's go back and keep reading. May your unfailing love come to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your promise. Let's stop there. Salvation is according to God's promise, the psalm says. When our boys were much younger, I developed a kind of tradition. Whenever I would go away on a trip, I was doing student ministry at that time, mission trip, retreat for a weekend, something like that, I would often bring them a little special treat when I came back. Just kind of started spontaneously, bring them candy or a t-shirt when they got older, something like that. So eventually, before I would go away, they would ask me, Dad, are you going to bring us something when you come back? And I'd say, yeah, I probably will. And they'd say, promise, Daddy? You promise? Because they knew if they could get me to promise, they had me. And I can remember many times coming back after a trip, driving into the driveway late at night, right as I pulled my car up, going, oh, I forgot. Driving back out, going to Jewel, getting a bag of Skittles, because I knew first thing in the morning they'd come down, Daddy, did you bring? You promised. Because they understood the power of a promise. What is a promise? The Hebrew word used here for promise can be translated according to your word. It's one word, but according to your word is what it means. God has given us his word as his promise. Now, what is salvation? The word used there means deliverance from oppression or victory in battle. Now, fast forward to the New Testament. We now know that salvation through Christ is deliverance from sin. We remembered that here this morning through communion and victory over death itself. And we know that God's salvation began with a promise way back in Genesis to a man named Abraham. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you, and all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you. It continued through the prophets, Isaiah 53, for he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. That's us, by the way. The promise was fulfilled in Christ. In John 3:16, we read, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. So what the psalmist is saying is that God promised. He promised his salvation through his word, and therefore his salvation can be trusted. And then the New Testament says that all God's promises are true in Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, for no matter how many promises God has made, they are all yes in Christ. Salvation is according to God's promise, and when God promises, he keeps that promise. Back to our text. May your unfailing love come to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your promise. Then I will answer the one who taunts me, for I trust in your word. Let's stop there. The one who taunts me. Salvation provides an answer to the one who taunts. Later this afternoon, between the chicken wings and the commercials, a football game is going to happen. And during that football game, it's very possible we could see a penalty for something called taunting. Taunting. I went right to the NFL rule book. Here's what it says. Taunting is the use of baiting or taunting acts or words that engender ill will between teams. A player or players engage in prolonged, excessive, premeditated, or choreographed celebrations. Taunting. Think about that for a minute. This is a professional football league for some of the biggest, fastest, toughest men on the planet. They are modern-day gladiators being paid hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars, to play a violent game where they intentionally inflict physical pain on each other. But if one of these men scores a touchdown and waves the ball in the face of the other guy going, nah, 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 you can't touch me, it's a penalty. Or if, heaven forbid, they engage in a choreographed celebration, it's a penalty. It's taunting. Basically, it's a penalty for hurting someone's feelings. 15 yards at $10,000. I think it's hilarious. But here the psalm writer is talking about the one who taunts. What's he talking about? Who's he talking about? Who is the one who taunts? The Hebrew word here means one who reproaches, who says sharp things against you. Now, if King David was the author, and many think he was, the one doing the taunting might be a pagan commander on the battlefield. Your army is nothing. We're going to destroy you. It might be one of his own people who critiques his leadership. I don't like your policies. You're a lousy king. But I think the author has something else in mind here, if I think of the whole of Scripture, something far more sinister. We know through Scripture that Satan has many names. He's the liar, the enemy, the deceiver, the slanderer, the evil one. But one of his names comes to us in Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. He's called the accuser of the brethren. The accuser. This is what Satan was trying to do to Jesus when Matthew 4, he tempts him in the wilderness. He says to him, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to turn into bread. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from the top of the temple. Surely the angels will catch you. He's taunting. In other words, I don't think you can do it. I don't think you are who you claim to be. And it's what Satan still does today. Now, I don't claim to know and understand the full range of Satan's activity. I know his authority is limited, but I also know that he taunts. He accuses. Look at yourself. You really think God loves you? How could God love someone like you? You call yourself a Christian? Look at what you did there. Look at what you said there. You're no Christian. You might as well give up. Who are you pretending to fool? Maybe you've heard his taunts. Maybe you know that voice. What's Jesus' response? Always the word. Always the word. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And what's our defense? Always the word. The psalm writer says, then I will answer the one who taunts me, for I trust in your word. This is why we must be growing in the word. For the word teaches us not only the promises of salvation, but teaches us about what I would call the guarantee of the Spirit. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, the Apostle Paul writes, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having been marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing your inheritance. The gospel tells us that when we confess Christ as Lord, when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we receive three gifts. First, the forgiveness of sin. We celebrated that here this morning. Second, the promise of eternal life. We'll talk about that in just a moment. And thirdly, the gift of the Holy Spirit. That is Jesus in spiritual form who indwells our hearts by his power and presence and seals, guarantees our salvation. Being in church doesn't seal our salvation. Being a good person doesn't seal our salvation. The gift of the Holy Spirit dwelling in our hearts seals the deal. So when the accuser comes, when the accuser taunts, when the accuser points his finger, we answer with the word. His unfailing love has come to me. My salvation is his promise. And I trust him at his word because he has sealed my heart. And that leads us then to the last verse today, verse 43. Do not snatch the word of truth from my mouth, for I have put my hope in your word. Hope is found in God's word. Some of you may not recognize the name Phil Robertson, but you probably recognize the face. He's the patriarch of a family that's become famous through the TV show Duck Dynasty. I never watched a single moment of the show until late last spring, early in the summer. I stumbled across an internet YouTube video of his faith story, of Phil Robertson's faith story. He talked about hearing and understanding the gospel for the first time, and he was far, far from God when he was in his late 20s. alcoholic, involved in all sorts of stuff. And he talked about how it took the blood of God himself to remove his sin. And then he said, I thought it was a mighty kind thing to do for someone like me. And it occurred to me, that's hesed. That's unfailing love. That's grace. And then he said, but it would do no good to have my sins removed, which are many, if something could not be done about the 6-foot hole I'm going into, and you too, by the way, he says. Then he talked about how the resurrection of Jesus from the dead guarantees that he will never die, that he will have eternal life. And he finishes with this. If you're not a believer and you don't believe God exists at all, about the only hope you have is that he not be there. What I'm saying is, I trust that he is. Straight out of 1 Peter chapter 1 in the New Testament. Peter writes, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you. Now we come back to hope. What is the living hope Peter talks about? Hope of new life now. In his great mercy, there's hesed again. Unfailing love. He's given us new birth. He's talking about spiritual rebirth, the birth of a new heart free from sin, the birth of new joy, being loved unfailingly, the birth of a new purpose, to love and serve Christ as Lord, the birth of a new hope, not hope as optimistic uncertainty, but a hope that can never perish, spoil, or fade, the hope of eternal life. Many of you may remember that it was 4 years ago, a little bit more, that my father had a major stroke. Early one Sunday morning, I got a call from my brother. Dad's had a terrible stroke. First doctor looked at his pictures, said zero chance of meaningful recovery. So we had a decision to make there on the phone. He in Ohio, me in Illinois, 5:30 in the morning. That decision was relatively easy for us with the information we had. My dad had told us many, many times, I'm ready for heaven. Part of me is already there. He has a son there. He has family members there, a lot of loved ones there. He said, if something happens to me, he would say to us, don't you dare bring me back. He's told us that, and we knew. Took us about 3 minutes. We made the decision, let him go. I'll get there as soon as I can. Then we got another phone call about 20 minutes later from the second doctor, had looked at the pictures and said we'd been given bad information. He had a completely different opinion. His condition is reversible, he said, so we had a much harder decision to make now. I mean, if we tried the procedure and it worked, we'd have her dad back. Great. Mom would have her husband back. But what if it only kind of worked? What if he couldn't speak again, or he couldn't walk again, or was severely limited in some way? What then? We knew he would be really upset with us. That's what we were afraid of. We thought and talked and talked and talked, and we decided to go for it. We told the doctor to do the procedure. He was right. It worked. My dad recovered in 24 hours and is healthy to this day. We're glad to have him back. We are. But he's made it very clear that his hope is not here. His hope is not here. His hope is there. It's in the inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. His hope is in the promise of God, and he committed to that lock, stock, and barrel a long time ago. So where is your hope today? We all have hope. Human beings can't live without hope. Is it in optimistic uncertainty? You hope just to be maybe good enough, that enough good outweighs the bad, and that's optimistic uncertainty. Or it is in a promise, the promise of God's unfailing love, the promise of his salvation, the promise of God's word, the promise of his spirit that seals your heart for all eternity. Will you bow with me in prayer? Lord God, we thank you today for your word. Teach us to delight in your word. Teach us to love your word. For in your word we find your unfailing love, hesed. In your word we find the promise of salvation. In your word we find the hope of eternal life. And may we respond. Open our hearts and allow your spirit to seal our salvation. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Would you please stand with me for the benediction today? As always, our prayer partners are available following the service. If you are carrying a burden in your heart today or want to pursue God's hope for your soul, then just come up. We'd love to spend that time with you. On your way out, remember our benevolent offering, which we take the first weekend of each month that we can serve other families in need. And remember, if you can stay around long enough to help us stack the chairs down high, we appreciate that very much. Receive now today's benediction. And we go now in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who fulfills in himself all the promises of God. Amen. Have a great day.